basically tell you what happens in the classroom. We look for solutions. We look for answers about life and living in textbooks. It's not in the textbooks. It's right in front of us. It's in the children. It's in us. But we never look here. We are looking into the textbook because that's what's been given into our hands. And we think we need to look at the textbook and we need to make sense of it. I grew up in Tamil Nadu during the anti-Hindi agitation. So I had this big block of wood when it came to Hindi. I just couldn't hear Hindi. I couldn't understand Hindi. And my mind had told me I cannot understand Hindi. So there I am in Delhi, going into a government school. And I find that the children are reading less Hindi than I am reading. I think this is not going to be possible at all. I am reading every little matra over there and I'm reading every little word and I'm trying to make sense of it. And the children are doing the same thing. When I ask them at the end of the sentence that they've read, iska matlab kya hai? They are not able to say anything at all. They almost, their faces seem to say, well, I've read this to you, haven't I? I mean, I put in so much effort in reading it to you and now why are you asking me for the meaning of it? I'm not focusing on meaning. I've read it to you. So, you know, the whole thing was, is reading enough? Or are we doing more with reading? What is it that we can do with children coming in from non-literate families? We said that the story was very, very important. We always say when we go into a classroom, when we go into class one, I do not know how many of you have used the NCERT textbooks. And then you go into class one with a textbook, the child has never been into preschool, and the child is coming in absolutely, you know, fresh into the classroom, doesn't know anything about reading, cannot probably recognize the shapes and the different sizes they are in. And they come in over there and they are given these bulky books. They have to do two books. While the NCERT curriculum and the syllabus says it should be an integrated syllabus. So we are looking at children who are trying to read two books where they cannot even read the first alphabet. And we are saying that our country is moving into 21st century skills for our children. We believe that it could be a story which makes this happen. Okay. So I'm asking you, what is the story? Why is it that story becomes very, very important for the work we are doing in schools? Is it possible for us to teach across the various subjects using the story? Is it possible or is it necessary or is it essential? Is it essential for children to go beyond what they've learned in the classroom into looking at becoming a good human being? Achcha insaan banne ke liye. What is the way in which you make a good human being? Is that the reason why we give education to our children? Or is there something else? Is there a way in which we can say that if I reach class 12 or I reach college or I reach beyond that and I have very good academic skills but I do not know what ethics is or I do not know how to behave, talk to one another or I don't have interpersonal skills, I don't have communication skills, but I'm a very good student. Is that enough? Can story pedagogy or can story make a difference in the way we look at this whole learning? Can it be a purna siksha that we are looking at rather than looking at learning as something that is contained within the four walls of a classroom? So this was the challenge that we were actually facing when we started working on these things. In 1992, we had the Babri Masjid and we had the, the Ram Janmabhoomi. The community that we work in is 50% Hindu and 50% Muslim. There are about 1,50,000 people. 50% Hindu and 50% Muslim. Till then, everybody was walking around. You know, the madrasa was there and, you know, the people would come and walk around. And at on Fridays, they'll be having their prayers and we'll all walk around. But during the Ram Janmabhoomi time, tempers flared. And people started saying, why do you own this road? Why are we walking around? Why cannot we have the right of way over here? It seemed like we were all very, very tolerant as long as we were not challenged. As soon as we were challenged and there were voices that were very loud on the other side, then we did not know how to move. We did not know how to answer these questions. And we went along with the mob. We went along with the loudest voice that we could hear. So at that time, we said, okay, is there something called passive tolerance and something called actively tolerant to what is happening around us. So when I'm looking at gender, when I'm looking at social causes, when I'm looking at, for instance, if my child is gay, then I'm up in arms. But if somebody else's child is gay, I say fine. I mean, I can be very tolerant about it. But it should not happen to me. So is there a possibility for us to move beyond the me and the my, into a we culture? So in 2001, we came up with what we call story pedagogy. And we started looking at all these issues, by which time in the 90s, India was becoming globalized. So we were looking at, you know, mass culture coming in. TV was becoming more and more effective. So we were looking at TV. We had mass culture. We weren't looking at the critical culture. We didn't know how to appreciate what was happening on TV. We were looking at a lot of languages that were coming in. English was becoming more and more important. We said that we don't want anything else but English. So if possible, we were moving towards it. We are seeing a lot of it now. So we are moving from a vibrant multicultural India to something which is monocultural. I'm also speaking English now. So we are all on the same platform of being very, very monocultural and very happy being monocultural. But this whole thing of tolerance, this thing of saying that, you know, we would like a country to preserve its plurality. We were wondering whether this could happen through story and whether we could be searching for answers to many of these issues that face us through story in the classroom. Now, there are two ways in which I think we can look at story in the classroom. I have that. Okay. One is to say that, okay, I'm bringing story into the classroom and I will bring this one story. I do not know how many of you have seen this book. I think it's there in Srishti. It's called Gijigad. The story is about the weaver birds who say that they go to God, they go to Devuda, and they go and tell Devuda, Devuda, you have given human beings lamps, but they didn't like their lamps. You have given the snake the little diamond that wears on its head. And you've given the owl eyes inside the head. But we are having our children inside our little nest. And there's no way that our children can be outside of the nest. They are constantly in darkness. And we would like them to be outside darkness and in some kind of a place which is friendly to them. Devuda doesn't have any answers at all. She says, let me think about it, but I really do not know if I can give you an answer. So the birds, the weaver birds, the Baya birds get together and they start talking together and then they find a solution amongst themselves. They say that, okay, we will talk to the fireflies. So they talk to the fireflies and the fireflies come and say that, okay, we will come in and light your nest. And even today, you will find that in the Baya bird's nest, the fireflies are there and they are lighting up the nest. It's a very simple story. It was written in Telugu by Gopni Karunakar. He's a very good, I wouldn't say he's a very well-known writer, but he's a fabulous storyteller who writes in Telugu. And Gopni Karunakar's story was retold for children and he brought it out as a little book for children in a big format. Now, when we looked at this story, you will find that the picture you have there, that is Devuda, that's the God. So when we started looking at God, many of our teachers said, God is masculine, it's a he. We do not have the concept, many of us do not have a concept of a woman goddess. We know, we all have, you know, Parvati and we have Shakti and we have all of them, but when you refer to God, it's always a he that we refer to. And here you'll find a fabulously old woman. It was an old woman who has been portrayed by Atanu Roy, the illustrator, as the God. And she doesn't have any answers at all. And you have these little birds over there who are asking, they are asking for equity. So, you know, when we started looking at what does the story mean in the classroom, it was first and foremost a lovely story that children could read, they could enjoy, they could find the words over there, they could sit and look at the words, they could sort of make a lot of sense out of the words itself. It led to something that we call the culture of silence. It was breaking that culture of silence. Because it was not an English story that was coming from outside. It was coming from within the culture that they knew. So this whole culture of silence which happens when you have some children who know English very well and another group of children who are not so comfortable in English sitting in the same classroom. Then the children who know English are the ones who are normally speaking up more. They are the ones who are attracting the attention of the teacher, the teacher also finds it much easier to call on them to give the answers than this other child. Because the other child has not gone through the whole lesson. She doesn't know what is happening over there. But with this kind of a story, when we took the story into our classroom, we found that it made it possible for the teacher to have a really good dialogue and a discussion with the children. And the children were able to come up with ideas on equity. We were looking at why is it that the Maya birds did not get something which all the others seem to have. Why is it that even those little fireflies like Gijigadu are having a little light? And why is it that the Maya birds don't have it? Why are human beings able to light a lamp? And why is the Maya bird not able to light a lamp? And we were doing it in our preschool, we were doing it in class 1, in class 2, and we found that many times they would say, we tell them it's a Telugu story. So what is Telugu? We don't even know what Telugu is. Because we all sit in Delhi, the children that I work with sit in Delhi, and they think the sun sets and rises in Delhi. It doesn't, there's nothing else in India. India is made up of Delhi. But when you tell them there is a language called Telugu, there are people living over there, and you can sort of start appreciating what is it that they are going through. What kind of lives are they leading? Then you find that we are all living similar lives. They are not very different. Then can we find somebody within our community who is speaking in Telugu? Can we find, then they found, you know, children that are talking in Rajasthani. For the first time they became aware that we have Rajasthani speaking children. Till then it was Hindi speaking. They went in and they found that children were speaking in Rajasthani. Then the songs came in. So what is the song that the child is singing? The Rajasthani song that they are singing. Vis-a-vis the Hindi song that is being taught in the classroom. So the mainstream language, which is Hindi, was getting broken up, and we were bringing in a lot of this excitement. We had children from Bihar, and then they brought in the Madhubani kind of drawing, and that was exciting. Because children had seen Madhubani when they had seen it in books, but they never really thought that there were real people who would sit down and draw that way, and there were children who could draw the Madhubani way of, you know, illustrating, of drawing. So we were finding that, you know, between all this, we had Punjabi children, Pulkari. They came in with Pulkari, and then, you know, when you started going into it deeper, this culture of silence which is there, that I'm this or I'm that, and I'm shy to say things, that got broken. Because in Delhi, South Indians really suffer a lot, because they prefer to hide under the cloak of anonymity, saying that, you know, I would rather not be standing out, I'd rather not be discovered as not belonging to Delhi, because Delhi sometimes can be very unforgiving of people coming from outside. And using stories like this made it possible for us to actually go and break this culture of silence and make it possible for children to think that there was and can be an equitable platform for one another to create for one another. This one, we were looking at water that was as part of the curriculum. All of us, right from class 1 to class 11, 12, we are looking at water in different ways. Whether it is water in chemistry, water in biology, we are looking at water as part of our language lessons, and everything was coming in. And Kata's way of doing things is story pedagogy helps us to be very, very integrated. So when we started looking at it, we brought in this story. We started with story. So it was a story which was talking about this Pradhan called Jishnu, who did not have water in his village, and what were the things that he did. And from that, we led the children on to looking at water that was needed in their community. Students, as part of their language classes, they wrote out the questionnaire. So they had to write a questionnaire on water, and they went into the slums, into their neighborhood, and they started asking these questions of the children. You'll find some of the girls there, and we had lots of them. We had little ones, we had big ones, we had lots of these children going out there and asking questions based on what they had read in the story. In the story, Vishnu is doing something which brings water to his village. And in the curriculum, you have water. But they were studying water within the four walls of the classroom. because of the way in which the story was coming into it, we were able to listen to the story of the child. The children were telling their own stories. They were saying, we do not get water. We have a problem with water. Then what is it? What's the way? Samadhan kya hai uske liye? Can you bring in some way in which you can address this issue of water? So the classroom was becoming not something that was a textbook directed and textbook focused lesson, but it became something much wider, which was looking at the community. So they went into the community and they measured, they went
there's a gradient, the thing goes up. So they had to measure the gradient, they had to see where the aquifers were, they had to say that, okay, if I can dig deeper, if I... So these are all being done by the children and with their teachers and with the community people over there. And this was a success that they had. They had the blue water lines. And we repeated it again, you know, a year ago, and we got more people coming in with from the 50 odd slums that we were getting. So when you're looking at story pedagogy, I just take 5 minutes to come in. In Katha, it's not just taking a story into the classroom. That's where we start. We start with taking a story into the classroom. And the child gets excited about the story. And before we even open the book, we are saying, what is the story of the child? In class one, the class teacher always starts with the story of the child. When the story says, when the child says her story, or we get the children sitting in a small group over there, and we all play these games with our children. They're all telling the story one to another, and we have a little audio recorder in the middle. And then they listen, they tell their whole story, and then it finishes. And at the end of it, we play, oh, mera awaz, that's my voice. You know, the excitement, the buying-in happens very naturally and automatically. You are not waiting for the child to come in and listen or say that, yes, I want to go to school every day. They are buying in because it is their story. Then the teacher or an older child takes the story of the children, of this thing, and they put it onto paper. Many times what happens after that is the child, each child starts telling her own story, a full story. Then that full story gets written out by somebody, maybe the teacher, maybe an older child. We have what we call a family room. We don't have a home room, we have a family room. So in the family room, the story gets written, and then the story gets illustrated by the child. And then it becomes Mamta's story, it becomes Irshad's story, and it's all kept in the library. So then Irshad is saying, "Ye mera kahani hai. Will you read out the story to me?" So you know, the process of reading and getting into reading becomes owned. It's an upcoming that comes over there. The ownership is happening over there, and so the children are moving forward with the story. After this comes what we call active story-based learning. Active being asking the question, because that's what the story is. It helps you to ask the question, why, how, why did this not happen, why did this happen, why cannot it be like this? You know, this whole thing of, you know, trying to change the ending, trying to change the way people are saying things, doing things. When I start looking at, you know, as a child, I start looking at various scenarios, I am coming to something that we think for the 21st century is very important, creativity. Creativity is the most important thing that the world is looking for. You can go from here anywhere, you can go to the US, you can go, I mean, lots of our children in Delhi schools are saying, we are not going to live here, ma'am, so why are you telling us this story? We are going off to the US or we are going off here. But wherever you go, they are not going to like you because you know your Madonna very well or you know your MTV very well. They are going to know you and they are going to respect you because you bring something from your backyard. You're bringing something from your culture. You're bringing something that is a unique selling proposition. What is that? That, I think, comes from knowing our culture, and that culture linking that has to happen comes from story. If we can make the story come into our classrooms, and if we are daring enough and bold enough to throw the books out of our classrooms, Katha has never had a book from 1990. Not a single textbook. Children never carry any textbooks into the classroom till class 10, 9. Class 9, we start off with their textbooks, and by then they are so confident about their reading, they are so confident about, you know, their sense of ethics is so strong, their sense of, you know, well-being is so strong, that, you know, when you give them the book, they are just giving it through, and that's one more hurdle that they have to cross to pass their exams and get down into the real world. It's not the be-all and end-all of life, because education is to create a good human being, is to create happiness for all, is to create an equitable platform. Education is for strong individuals to be created who can go on and create a strong society. If we have individuals who are just looking after themselves, we'll never have a society which can then look after them. We know that with animals, we know that with nature, we know that with human beings. But somewhere down the line, we've skewed up everything and we've said that education is the be be-all and end-all of education is to be recognized for who I am, without thinking that I belong to a country, a proud country called India, that I belong to a storytelling tradition. You know, of all the languages that we have in our world, very few have storytelling cultures. India is one of the few. Every language you take has a storytelling culture.